But I also know his wife is not very well. They have a place in Florida. I don't know how long he'll be there, but I'm thinking under the next president, he might leave. Ruth Bader Ginsburg, I helped get Ruth on the district bench. Carter was the one who appointed her. Yeah, she's been great. One of the stories you may not know is her husband is a tax lawyer. He does the taxes for, I don't know, I'm going to guess here because I don't know his client list, I bet half the U.S. Senate. So every time Ruth is up, guess who can speak to the members of the Senate? He's been very influential in her career, but she's been very influential for all of us. In fact, in the most recent abortion-related case, she dissented because, and I'll tell you about that in a minute, but she not only dissented and wrote the dissent, she read her dissent on the floor of the U.S. Supreme Court to emphasize how opposed she was to the decision of the Supreme Court. Ruth is now 75. She had colon cancer a few years ago. She looks so frail. Now, I must admit, she has looked sort of frail for as long as I've known her. But she really looks frail, and that makes me worry a lot. I think she'll be there until her last moment. But I do worry that in another 4 years that there might be a vacancy there. And then I was in Washington at the museum. You know, it's a new museum about news, so I gave a speech there just recently. And I happened to run into Nina Totenberg with NPR, and she said, you know, Sarah, what you ought to be worrying about is Souter. And I said, Souter? Why Souter? And she said, he's homesick. He doesn't really like living in Washington. If he had a chance, he probably would think about leaving. So who's the next president is going to have? I noticed the reporters now are saying 2 or 3 vacancies. So I don't know how many there'll be. I just know there are going to be some. And the president's going to make those appointments. And the Supreme Court now is basically 4 for us, 4 against us, and Kennedy in the middle, but leaning against us. And so who's president and who they appoint to the Supreme Court and who sits on that body in the future is going to be absolutely critical for us and for the future. President makes those appointments, so who's that going to be? Well, that's why I'm here to talk to you. I'm doing a lot of work now, pro-choice. So I've done a lot of push calls against McCain. I'm working with the Republican majority for choice because they are also against McCain because they want the Republican Party to go back to its historical support for choice and for other good causes. It was only about 1970 that the Republican Party became so opposed. So I'm working with everyone who is pro-choice, trying to be sure that the person elected president will appoint pro-choice judges. McCain is anti. If you look at the website, you'll see a lot of the documentation. I could give it to you, but I want to tell you just a couple of quick things. You have been so important in Washington. You've put into law things that could make you a haven for women who need to find a place to go. And so I came at Karen's invitation, but really for all of you, just to underscore how important you are on a national level. If you come to my office, and oh, I've got to show you one more picture and then I'm going to close. This is the picture when the federal bill that the Supreme Court upheld was signed. I love the caption. You can see Bush and you can see those who were the key people with that piece of legislation. And the caption reads, "Would anyone who's ever had a gynecological exam please raise your hand?" It's a great comment on that picture. If you come to my office, as you come in the door, you will see a picture of the March on Washington. I was lucky enough to be one of the speakers, and it was such a wonderful moment. Some of you I've met since I've been here have said we were there. It was a great moment, an outpouring of the support for the principle that people should be able to make their own choices. Just above it is a handmade goose quill pen. When you argue a case in the U.S. Supreme Court, at your place is a handmade goose quill pen. It's a souvenir for you to take for having argued there because so few people ever get to do that. And then as you come down my office hallway, you will see a color picture of the U.S. Supreme Court of 1973, with each of the judges having signed it. And sometimes people will say, can you get one of, because it's every, all of the judges I argued before and who signed the Roe versus Wade opinion. Sometimes people will say, well, can you get one if you lose? I say, I don't know. I've never lost in the U.S. Supreme Court. The truth is, we've won together. It is the elected officials who are here who keep winning here. And it is to them and to all of you, to Karen, to all of you who are important and narrow, that I bring you a word of thanks for people all over the country, that you are a beacon that could be here for all of us who live in states that might not be as enlightened. But in the meantime, we've got a big job, and that is we need a pro-choice president in the White House. Thank you.